Good morning, everyone. On behalf of the partner organizations that have taken part in the convening of this meeting, I would like to extend a very warm welcome to this public event, presenting the final report of the Commission for the Clarification of Truth and celebrating its legacy to heal the profound wounds in the Colombian society. We would like to express thanks for you being here, those who are here in person at the Institute of Peace headquarters, as well as those listening in online. A special warm welcome to the groups of victims who have traveled from a number of states of the United States to be with us here today. I'm Steve Hagee. I am the Assistant Director for Latin America here at the Peace Institute, USIP. For those who don't know this institute, the Peace Institute is a public institution, yet autonomous, that does not fall under the executive branch with a congressional mandate going back to 1984 to promote the prevention, mitigation, and conflict, the resolution of conflict, violent conflict throughout the world in Colombia. The Institute has been working for 20 years, offering support for a number of peace-building initiatives at the national level and the different territories. So it's my privilege to head up the Institute's office in Bogota. Now, from our main headquarters in Washington, it's a true pleasure and honor for us to have with us three commissioners from the Truth Commission, Dr. Saul Franco, Commissioner Alejandra Miller, and Francisco de Rue, Father Francisco de Rue, who presides over the commission. We hope that your presence here and your thoughts can shed light on this process and inspire all of us who humbly seek to be peace advisors in Colombia and elsewhere. It's been a privilege for us to be partners among many other international partners in the support that we offer and in following through with the Commission's mandate. The Commission was created within under the Peace Accord signed in 2016 between the State of Colombia and the FARC movement to define causes and responsibilities for the armed conflict and to make recommendations for non-repetition and non-continuity of what happened that caused so much pain and trauma to Colombian society beyond drafting a report, which is very valuable. The Commission has also undertaken an even more challenging task of facilitating processes and opportunities for reconciliation and healing, including a number of very moving encounters between victims and responsible parties, such as leaders of the FARC and of law enforcement. And so we thank our partners who have taken part in convening this. We've got the Washington Office for Latin America, WOLA, the Working Group on Latin America Law, the Colombian Committee on Human Rights, the Kroc Institute of the Notre Dame University, and Humanity United. Before starting with the presentations by the commissioners and then to open up the floor for any questions from the audience, I would ask Jimena Sanchez, the director for the Andean region under WOLA, to offer some introductory thoughts on behalf of their respective organizations. Jimena and Lisa Hogard have been partners of the Peace Institute over the years and have followed closely the work of the commission here in Washington as well as in Colombia. Jimena Sanchez, please come forward. Thank you very much, Steve. I thank the Peace Institute for organizing this very important event today. It's an honor for me to be here with Father de Rue, commissioners of the Truth, Commissioner Cristina Spinel, and victims, and the Ambassador of Colombia. Now, on behalf of WOLA, I would like to commend the Truth Commission for having fulfilled this task, and the words fail me, this tremendous undertaking of producing a report which brings together a coherent narrative of abuses in the country during the internal armed strife of nearly more than 60 years. This is a very sophisticated report on mark, on point, which gathers witness testimony of victims and also of thousands of victims of the country. I would like to underscore how important the methodology used with ethnic groups was with prior consultation to engage them and to gain their participation. And this was something that was done during the pandemic with all the attendant restrictions. The Truth Commission also had to work under a post-conflict political climate, which was not very conducive to it. It was a hostile environment when, from the government and other sectors, there was disagreement with moving forward with the peace process, and which on the occasion, they actively tried to undermine the peace process, a concessional peace process. It wasn't easy, but you did fulfill your obligations vis-a-vis peace, reconciliation, and victims, setting off a platform, setting in motion a platform, which will serve as a jumping board for reconciliation and non-repetition. The result of your effort is a manifold thesis that looks into the prolonged conflict in Colombia from the standpoint of victims and all the other armed actors, focused on the humanitarian and human impact, leading to internal fissures within the Colombian society. The report focuses on presenting the truth from the standpoint of the victims, underscoring the cost that this entailed in a differentiated perspective toward women, Afro-Colombians, indigenous groups, from the gender perspective, and LGBTIQ, showing the consequences of when structural racism, discrimination, historic discrimination, and classism comes together with class strife, contributing to violence and conflict. The report also underscores the role played by the United States in the internal armed conflict, owing to the close relationship between the United States and Colombia in the area of security and the fight against drug trafficking. Its recommendations focus on promoting peace, using all of the actors with the justice approach, and to fight corruption and implementing a transforming reform of law enforcement with the rights focus. Now that this report has been focused, it falls to all of us within Colombia and outside of Colombia, Colombians and allies alike, to help to mend the Colombian society, transform it to avoid repetition. Now, it's absolutely important for legislators and other stakeholders in the United States receive this report with seriousness. A debate needs to be held on how the United States contributed to the crimes committed during the conflict and what it can do toward peace. Our legislators need to draw lessons from how to reform police in Colombia and its anti-drug policy, changing them to help build peace, to bring human security or safety, and to build sound, solid institutions, and to provide a framework for addressing structural problems, long-standing structural problems that victims and the people of Colombia face. There are 17 macro territories now where the armed conflict is focused, which requires that those recommendations made in the ethnic part of this report is addressed, be undertaken. Hopefully, President Biden is going to prioritize these topics and also to undertake the efforts to mitigate or do away with racism. We have yet to thoroughly consolidate peace throughout the territory. We all need to work together to take into account these conclusions and that they be used to achieve this complete peace. WOLA is working toward this total peace, and we underscore the voices of ethnic groups and of women, and we are more than willing to continue working and pushing forward on this agenda, following through on this report. In both countries, you can count on us. It's an honor for me to be here with the members of the Truth Commission and the members of the community of victims in exile who are here in this room. The Truth Commission offers an opportunity which is granted once in a generation for us to reflect on how a society found itself enmeshed in violence and suffering, plunged into violence and suffering. And it's an unusual opportunity as well for us to try to correct the errors of the past and to build the path forward, a better future. The Truth Commission of Colombia is precisely that, a unique opportunity for us to halt the cycle of violence which has cost 450,000 lives. This report should not be viewed as a bunch of tomes that get shelved for only those studying the conflict would read, but a living document that will guide our path toward change. When you look at the heart-wrenching testimonies of in the analysis by the report, you'll see that all of the armed sectors, from the guerrillas to paramilitary groups and the armed forces themselves of Colombia, all committed terrible acts of violence and cruelty. But you also see many other actors, some members of the national government, operators of justice, and local and regional governments as well, Colombian businesses and multinationals, as well as international donors, played a direct role, or at least by omission, contributed one way or the other to this violence. The Colombian society must reflect on this and change. And also, the United States must reflect and change, given that it offered so much support to the government of Colombia and the armed forces of Colombia during the period in which the human rights violations by many different armed groups, including the armed forces of Colombia, were ramped up and reached their peak. We also must reflect on the very positive role that the United States played and hopefully will continue to play in building peace in Colombia in recent years. With the publication of the Truth Commission's report, at this historic juncture in which a new government is coming into office in Colombia, this is a true opportunity for progress. It's not just a time to listen, but to act on the recommendations issued by the Truth Commission to broaden the implementation of the peace accords of 2016, including the ethnic chapter on reforms, of your reform. The time has come to go back to negotiating with ELN for peace to reach the territories and to achieve more complete peace. It's a time for us to undertake more energetic actions to dismantle the paramilitary networks and of organized crime that continue causing deaths in communities and undermining the rule of law. It's a time for us to reflect and to transform the drug policy of the U.S. that affected negatively Colombia, and to undertake the structural reforms within the armed forces and the police of Colombia to make law enforcement security more humane and to protect human rights defenders and social leaders whose lives continue in jeopardy. And it's time for us to truly hear the victims of violence and to recognize their dignity, the trauma that they suffered, the resilience that they have displayed, and the visions that they have for a peaceful Colombia. Thank you.
Muchas gracias, Jimena.
Thank you, Jimena and Lisa. Now, in representation of the victims in exile who have played a proactive role in the commission's activities. We have asked the founder of the Colombian Committee for Human Rights, Cristina Spinel, to collaborate with us by moderating today. Cristina is a very close friend of the Institute of Peace for many years and has been a renowned fighter, someone who has fought for human rights and peace in Colombia for three decades now. After hearing her words and those of the commissioners, we're going to learn more about the process that was facilitated by the commission for the victims. You have the floor, Cristina. Thank you very much. I would like to ask Steve, if you would mind, if I were to talk a bit about what our experience was as volunteers for the commission. Your perspective and that of the U.S. as we started doing this work. So the experience with the Truth Commission has been very enriching, and I would like to share this experience with you. On one of the trips that Alejandro Valencia did, who at the time was a commissioner, said that they were seeking an organization that could support them for the commission to come and tell us what their objectives were, what their mission was. Immediately, I responded, Alejandro, Colombia Human Rights Committee, I said, is an organization that has been working with the victims of the conflict, receiving them. And so it has been a pleasure for us to take part in this very worthwhile effort. In June of 2018, we received the first visit of the commission led by Carlos Bernstein, who is charged with working with victims in exile. For that visit, we held a number of meetings with NGOs. And in the afternoon, we held a meeting with the victims. And that meeting was very moving because here in Washington, that was the first time so many victims gathered and sat down to tell us what their experience had been. And this is something that you will always carry with you in your heart and mind. So Father Pacho, as we call him, was with us from the 14th of November, working with Adam Isaacson. They helped organize his visit. That visit was quite extensive. We had meetings with NGOs, with the U.S. State Department, with congressmen, with USAID universities such as Georgetown and George Washington. We had to go to George Washington. It's a Georgetown University, rather. It's a Jesuit university, and they wanted to receive this visit. At the meeting with victims, there were victims that came from New Jersey, New York, and from the metropolitan area of D.C. After all of these different activities, between 21 and 23 of February of 2020, Commissioner Carlos Bernstein started training those people that we wanted to, whose witness testimony we wanted to take. That training was done in Philadelphia. People came from different parts of the United States to that training session, such as, again, New York, New Jersey, Philadelphia, people from North Carolina, and we, after receiving that training, were close to starting this effort. It was very moving to put into practice what we had been preparing for. We were ready to start when the pandemic hit, and of course we were thwarted, and that was very frustrating because we had to change the methodology from in-person to virtual. And the victims were a bit wary, and rightfully so. But little by little, we started to gain their trust, and we assured them that it was going to be safe. There would be no problem interviewing them virtually. Now, just a personal note, my personal experience, I was a victim only of being followed by state security agents in Colombia. Now, why did they follow me? I was a volunteer, and I offered, I was sympathetic to political prisoners in Colombia, and that caused trouble for me. But I had the good fortune, those who guided me enabled me to leave Colombia without any difficulty and arrive here.
But when I left Colombia, I had in my heart and in my mind the face of those political prisoners. We had seen them suffering for so many years in the jails. I carried them with me in my mind, and that was what gave me strength, and what still gives me strength today, to continue onward, to be able to do something with them from here in the U.S. Okay. Upon hearing the testimonies of the victims, my heart shattered. I couldn't have on my mind so many people suffering at the hands of all of the legal and illegal armed groups in Colombia. And with these testimonies that were given, we have managed to create a truth in the country. But we also learned that there are two Colombias. And there are two stories. What was the role of the Truth Commission? The Truth Commission's job was to unite these two stories so that we could make one Colombia again. And that has been very brave. We thank the Truth Commission for that and for their work in exile. The Truth Commission has ended its period, but it has not ended its work. There's still much work to do. We must spread the information contained in this report. We are going to spread it to every corner of the earth. There won't be any corner left in this earth that does not know about what happened. Why? Because there is a future if there is truth. Thank you very much.
Bueno, ahora sí.
I ask for your forgiveness now. We are going to go into the presentation of the commissioners. Here we have Father Pacho, as we call him. Father Francisco de Rue. He's a Jesuit who has worked with local and international peace groups in Colombia for 3 decades. He also has studied philosophy, and Father de Rue is also a master of economics. He studied economics at the University of Paris. He wrote several books about ethics and social development, among other things. Father de Rue, 15 years ago, founded an organization in Magdalena Medio for peace and development. This was an area that was highly affected by the guerrilla and paramilitary activity. Padre de Rue, it is your turn. Thank you. I am very moved to see all of you here with us today. Thank you for coming. And thank you because your presence reaffirms something that we feel in Colombia. This is a very special moment for us. It's a moment of truth-telling. We all are feeling this bravery emerge. And we all need to work together to make this future possible. Thank you, of course, to those who are here who are victims, who are living in exile, and who have had to face the tremendous difficulties of living in exile because they don't have a home in Colombia. Because in Colombia, they could kill them. They came and built a new life in difficult conditions. Thank you for being here. Because you are doing what we have been working towards in the commission to determine the truth, to tell the stories of the victims. We have presented all of this with great passion. The victims of the paramilitary groups, of the guerrillas, of the Colombian state itself. There are 6 different groups of victims that we are supporting. One of your friends, Steve, another fellow father, has been working directly with these groups. When the victims arrived there, the first thing that they did in front of everybody, and these were victims that had never even spoken to each other before, victims from a completely destroyed village, destroyed by the paramilitaries, and then speaking with the victims of a town destroyed by the guerrillas. And everybody was working towards the same thing. And we saw how far we had gone as Colombians to destroy the other. We saw how far we were able to go to use this ability to completely destroy, but without even reaching an agreement, one after another, the victims who were there managed to come out of their own skin and say that Colombians are not just that. We're here because we're willing to look each other in the face once more and to move forward hand in hand together. And to build our country in a different way. There was an indigenous person from the Cauca region who spoke about her daughter and her daughter's boyfriend who were assassinated by the paramilitaries in a party in the town on a Saturday night. And what happened afterwards? It showed up in the newspapers the next day, and this indigenous person took a large receptacle and raised it and said, "We're here to continue Colombia's night. Please come and join us. Let's sit down together and let's raise a glass to our children who have passed on, who were murdered. I am really grateful to all of you who are here today. Thank you, of course, to Jimena. Thank you for being here with us. And thank you, Lisa, for presenting the report. You left us without words. You did such a great job. And of course, Christina, the fight, your work, the work that you guys are doing is so special. I would just like to say to you, I look forward to hearing our companions here today. And I'm happy to be here with Alejandra, who has been with the commission since the very beginning. And she's provided the female perspective to this entire situation. She's made sure that that has been well established here. She is a very important feminist in Colombia, and we are happy to have her presence as part of this mission. There is a lot to say about the women in Colombia, and this is very important. One other important thing was to insist upon listening directly to people. There are many secondhand reports out there, and those are great, but it is especially important to hear firsthand testimony here today. Of course, Alejandra insisted that it wasn't just women, but it was everybody. The entire gamut. Of people who suffered. And then we also have Commissioner Sal Franco here. I'm not going to get into his resume, but for us, he has not just been the heart of this organization and this effort, but his presence has been especially important in a very important and challenging region on the border of Colombia and Venezuela. And he has thoroughly given himself over to this task. And he has connections to the academic world, which has been helpful. We appreciate the rigor and clarity, conceptual clarity that he has provided to us. He's been a great colleague to work with. And then we have Maria Prada. Please stand up. Maria is our chancellor. Thanks to Maria, we were able to get tremendous international collaboration. I wanted to call your attention to this because it seems very important to me. Thank you for being here with us. You don't know how happy we are to know that you will be our ambassador of Colombia here in Washington. And I'm happy to see the presence today of the Afro-Colombian groups in Latin America. The strength, the intelligence, the passion for life. And for us, that has been tremendous. And other extraordinary leaders who are here. I would just like to say to you that something that profoundly affected me in this entire process, I've spoken about this in the past, that was to discover that the vast majority of Colombians who were affected or died in this process were civilians, the vast majority of every 10 people affected, 8 were civilians. And possibly of the 450,000 people who perished in the conflict, at least 370,000 were civilian. This was not a civil war. This was a war against civilians. Or against more than the hundreds of thousands of women and their children. And lastly, I just want to say that I was also impacted by hearing from paramilitary kids who were fighting. And the guerrilla kids who are fighting. I don't know how many there were, but somewhere between 80,000 and 90,000 young Colombians who are all Colombian citizens, Christian or Catholic, all from the same country, who killed each other in this useless war when they came into conflict and they went out to kill. And that's all for now. Thank you. Sometimes the role of moderator is a little bit cruel. But we would like everybody to listen, and then we'll have time for questions. It's very interesting. Okay, Alejandra. Alejandra Miller is leading the feminist movement in Colombia. She's a journalist, and she's studying politics. She's from Escalera, but she's been living in Cauca for quite some time now. She works for the local government. At the Truth Commission, she has been working on the issue of gender and the territorial issues in the Cauca region. Alejandra, we're listening to you with great anticipation. Thank you so much. Thank you, Pacho, for being here. Thank you, all of you, for being here at this meeting. It is an extremely emotional moment for us to be here with you. And this is in person, not virtually. This is very special to be here to tell you about some of our achievements. Very quickly, I would like to tell you that there's more than 900 pages, and just part of that is the Truth Commission, and that is a very extensive report telling about all of the years of war. There we have the voices and testimonies of the people, of the victims that the commission heard, more than 30,000 people. These individuals and groups of people who told their stories for the report. In the first chapter, we have the recommendations and achievements presented on June 28th, and I'll refer back to that later on. We have other chapters that I would just like to quickly mention to emotionally prepare you for that reading, to see if we can bring you together to get into that reading, to delve right into it. There is a narrative that seeks explanations. It's a narrative to reveal the truth. It has many elements to it, likely interpretive, but that's there where we find and analyze many explanations for the armed conflict. This chapter is very important. It will be published next week on our website, and it's really worthwhile because it tells the entire story of the armed conflict and the reasons why it happened, because it is really important to know the history behind it.
Now, there's an extensive chapter on human rights violations that delves deeply, taking much witness testimony in reference to 17 different types of human rights violations, forced disappearances, murder, forced recruitment, sexual violence, 17 descriptions, thorough descriptions of what actually happened to people and the grave human rights violations. We have a chapter on LGBTI plus women and men that captures experience of women, but especially not just the pain they suffered, but we delve into explanations about what actually happened, why women went through this, and why these women in particular. And so we offered some explanations, but this is a chapter that shows, as Pacho was saying, the strength, the unstoppable power and strength of the women. Now, having headed up this chapter and working with women for so long, I am thoroughly convinced that Colombia would be much worse off had it not been for what the women did in the war. They held up the country. They kept it going with all that they did, with their resistance, their protection of life and the lands, territories, and LGBTI plus persons as well. There's the ethnic chapter that stresses the overlap of the structural violence and the armed conflict. and the resistance or pushback of the Afro-Colombian peoples and indigenous peoples. And there's also a section on what happened to the gypsy community there, not much known. There's a chapter on boys and girls, adolescents, that shows what they went through being recruited forcibly and what their very painful experience was during the war and trying to rebuild their lives. Another chapter on exile. And you, being outside of Colombia, know all about that. And this shows a Colombia that's very important. The different regions, territories of Colombia, which make it up. And how, from the outset, historically speaking, colonization and exclusion are what actually drew the lines between these territories or provinces and the great disparities that exist in levels of development, as well as participation in building the nation and the life of the country and their differentiated involvement in the war itself. So this is a 13 collections of regions where the Truth Commission worked, and this offers a social, political, historic account of the conflict in these regions. So I think people are going to be very pleased to see the history of their territories in the history of their territories is in this report. And also there's a part that addresses exactly what happened to the rural workers, the peasants. There's another chapter on the impact on people, what happened to nature, society, culture, democracy, and that's going to be addressed later on as well. And the resistance, the force of Colombian people to rise again and to rebuild. There's another chapter, which is really moving, that is a curation of a witness testimony of all types of testimony, especially of victims of all the different armed parties as well. Those being held responsible, 30,000 witness testimonies that we took at the Truth Commission, all very moving, and just hearing the voice of the victims speaks for itself. There is no interpretation overlaid over this, just the voices of the people of the victims. This is very easy to read, it's very moving, it's heart-wrenching, it's hard to read, but as I said, that is where you really see the force, the power of the Colombian people. Now, I would like to, that just by way of enticing you to read this, I have 4 minutes left, and so briefly, I would like to talk about our findings. The first finding, a couple of them, have to do with what we call the harm to Colombia, the pain. Pacho gave us some figures, but the most hair-raising is that we had between 450,000 victims, people who were murdered during the armed conflict, that's 80% of which were civilians. In just a couple years of the conflict, that itself is frightening, but 50,000 people were abducted in this conflict, 16,000 boys and girls who were forcibly recruited. I think that's underreported, and that might actually be as high as 30,000. Those are based on our estimates, but 16,000 documented case of forced recruitment, 30,000 victims of sexual violence, women, again, another underreported case, we think, given how hard it is for a woman to report such a crime, 8 million displaced, 120,000 disappeared. So that goes to show the magnitude of the human tragedy here. take all of the dictatorships together in the Southern Cone, and it doesn't add up to this dimension of human rights violations. Another finding on democracy, because one asks, how could we have kept a democracy going in the midst of the massive human rights violations and the violence in Colombia? So democracy is one of the topics we wanted to stress in this analysis, not by way of explaining it, but rather just to show how a democratic system could coincide with an armed conflict of such dimension. And you will find here many aspects related to what we call the openings and the closings of democracy. The most important finding is to showcase how the few opportunities for a democratic opening up in the country that we've had in our history resulted from the peace process itself, and how war systematically shut down that democracy. And so it's a series of opening and closing and restarting of democracy over that time period. And during that decade was when we had the when the conflict reached a head, in which 75% of the victims of the armed conflict happened during the peak of the conflict. In our findings, we have some other aspects. Just two more minutes, if you would allow me. This is something we wanted to show. It's very important for the commission to show what the paramilitary groups did, what the guerrilla did, the law enforcement, their background, their origin, their causes, what motivated them, the dynamic with which they worked. It was also very important to substantiate how this wasn't just a war of armed groups. That's one of the biggest findings of the commission. This is a war. There was a structure of this war in which vast sectors of society also took part. After all of the armed groups, there were interests, economic interests at play, political interests, and ideological interests at play. But this war entailed society beyond what was the armed aspect of it, the guerrilla and the armed groups, military, paramilitary groups, and the human rights violations resulting from that, and the stripping of land rights and other human rights violations. Pacho perhaps might have a little more to say about the security model that needs to be transformed, that was very much rooted in that time period of the Cold War, trying to vanquish a domestic threat, those who had risen up in arms. That's part of the war, but this also entails civil society and citizenry. This idea of there being an internal enemy spread to other places. The communal board and the first the front of Primera Línea. And so this concept of an internal enemy became a model of security based on that. And that's not really rooted on protecting people's lives, on protecting humans' lives, but rather protecting people's wealth, protecting wealth. And so, and that's the milieu in which the whole false positive phenomenon emerged. We're talking about people who are massacred and giving response to that. And so now I'll conclude talking about drug trafficking. There are two other findings I wanted to talk about, but drug trafficking is very important because that is one of the novel aspects here in the analysis done by the commission. The mandate given to us was for us to talk about what happened with drug trafficking within the armed conflict. And what we identified is that the drug trafficking thrived from the persistence of the armed conflict, but what we also saw was that it goes beyond being the driving force. That is, it provided resources for the armed conflict. Of course, it provided money and resources for war, but not just that. Drug trafficking has some political facets to it. And it's still there. It hasn't ended. And so we tried to show the deep ties between drug trafficking with political and economic interests and the war itself, which is part of which you'll see in our findings. And something that's also really hard-hitting is something that we mention here and the meaning that it has for the country, the failure of the war against drugs. That's a clear message. The war against drugs in Colombia just deepened and worsened the impact and the reach of the armed conflict and the negative effects that it had on people, the thousands of peasants who were forced to leave their lands because of fumigation or spraying. So these findings, we have to look at these from a systemic approach with the historic context. These are all factors that contributed to the persistence of this conflict. There could have been many disarmament processes and resumption of a conflict had we not gone so deeply into these findings. Without this, it would be we'd be hard-pressed to talk about any type of sustainable, long-standing peace, because it would be really easy for people to rearm and resume conflict.
Desafortunadamente, el tiempo.
Unfortunately, time is never on our side, but your presentation encourages us to continue delving into these findings that you produced. Saul Franco is a doctor with a doctorate degree in public health. He has 40 years as a university professor. He has devoted his life to researching epidemiology of violence in the armed conflict of Colombia and in Latin America and its impact on the lives and health of people and communities. He has worked advising international organizations in the areas of health, culture, human migration, and human rights. You have the floor, Saul, and thank you very much for coming. Thank you, Christina. I would like to thank all of you for being here. Some having come from different areas, different regions, and I think everyone who has made this encounter possible. Now, there are three people not here. I would like to talk about two are definitively missing. Salazar, who is a companion on the Truth Commission, who died 2 years ago by COVID. But Angela Salazar's presence, she's with us in our hearts and our minds. Alfredo Molano, our other fellow commissioner, who also passed away, not because of COVID, but owing to other problems. A few months before Angela died, but he continues to inspire our research and our commitment to listen. The indigenous people, the peasants throughout the country. And so these two people, whose absence we sorely feel, we still feel their presence, and they still illuminate our path in this process. And there's a temporary absence, Mr. Bernstein, another commissioner, who was the driving force and the soul in the mind of this work with the Colombian exile. I was exiled. I left in 87, first in Brazil and then here in Washington for two more years. But I wasn't devoted to this topic with the same passion, intensity, and heart with which Carlos Bernstein did, because this isn't just this Truth Commission isn't novel, only novel, but it's also, it opened a door for similar processes to hear the and understand the role of those who are in the exile and who desire to go back to their country in peace. An applause for Carlos. Now, in the 8 minutes and 50 seconds that I have left, I'm going to focus on a couple of topics. First, under the chapter that fell to me to coordinate within the commission, I was focused on the impact of the conflict and people's ability to deal with the war and to continue forging ahead and contribute to rebuilding the peace. This volume is called Suffering Through the War and Rebuilding Your Life. This war caused untold suffering in Colombia and continues to do so, not just because of the large number of deaths, and I would like to say we speak of 450,000 from 75 till now. Those, what about from 58 to 85? And the whole period in which there were no records, they're not in the database. We didn't include them because we had to be very rigorous, but they still died and in the mountains and were cremated by the paramilitary groups, such as what happened in the north of Santander and the crematories that were there in Villa del Rosario. Where are these dead people? They aren't accounted for. That's why that figure of 450,000 is very modest in my view. It's a number we came up with because we could substantiate it, but there's no doubt that at least 700,000 Colombians, men and women, died in this, and by far many more than that even. And that has led to women being left widows, people being orphaned, enormous poverty resulted from this. Much pain was wrought by this war, changing people's lives. You've got the peasants who lost their land and were forced to leave. They lost their close ties, relationship with the nature, their animals, their crops. And what about the people who were abducted? That's very painful. Forced. At least 110,000 people were forcibly disappeared. That's the most profound pain or wound that cannot heal. Now, if you recover a dead relative, you can then bury that person in a given place, and that's where you can focus your mourning. And so this caused a harm to physical and mental health. And this is something that we focus on, the mental health harm caused, not just psychiatric diagnoses, so many cases of depression, of any other type of mental pathology. No, I'm talking about the loss of joy, of tranquility, of emotional balance, the possibility to enjoy one's life. That is what was altered. Absence of sexual violence, for example, it's not just physical damage caused by that, which does happen, but that, and it's awful to say that, but that's the least part of the harm. It's the denial of that peace that's been taken away from the person who fell victim to that. So this is much pain, untold pain, harm caused to all forms of life and well-being. Something else that strikes us is the awful harm this war did to democracy. Democracy was hard hit by this. How many former combatants of the different peace processes died? Only the paramilitary groups say that more than 5,000 former paramilitary people died. Now, those who signed the agreement of FARC, 333 of those who signed it or were part of that process died. That has harmed democracy. But in addition to that, the social organizations of the young people, union leaders who are persecuted, stigmatized, singled out simply because they belonged and worked for a human rights organization. Democracy has shrunk. It has really been harmed. Not just the parties of the left suffered, the Liberal Party, the Conservative Party also lost. How many congressmen, mayors, former mayors, parliamentarians, and so forth? This war had huge costs for democracy, and the armed organizations in many regions decided who could vote. They would burn the polling places. And so the harm that this war caused to democracy is huge. I would also say that nature was very damaged, not just the scene of the war, but nature was another victim of the war in many ways. The bombing that tore the ground apart, the anti-personnel mines, and most of the victims of these anti-personnel mines were law enforcement agents who also lost many lives. And that's also had a ripple effect in many sectors. And this commission researched that and recognizes this. And we've published this. We don't have a bias this or that way. We have to, with dignity and bravery, point out all the different the parties who were responsible for this. What about rivers and waterways? Fishermen who have said that they don't fish anymore because the only thing they caught were hands and limbs, and because the rivers became repositories for cadavers, so nature suffered. What about the fumigation? How many years has that been happening? And illegal mining? How much mercury has been dumped into the rivers? And so nature was damaged, deforestation, and so forth. So this is a very serious type of damage. And also the culture was damaged. Culture isn't just art and music, but also that suffered. Culture, referring to how we live, how we relate to nature, our beliefs and the values that we have, and people's beliefs, people's values, people's rituals were all deeply affected by the war. There were paramilitary groups who say that they can't even mourn and cry for the people that they killed. Mourning was prohibited. That customarily is something that takes place over a couple of days, but it was prohibited. Culture. How many indigenous people were murdered, and that is an interruption of their culture. It's an interruption of their culture. So the harm to people's values and culture, drug trafficking, which inserted itself in this conflict, changed the people's values. So that was a large-scale change. I'm not going to talk anymore about the impacts, but this war did have a real impact, and it has sullied, has left stains. Some impacts trigger others. Displacements uproot people, force people to move to other cities. A lot of them turn to prostitution, to begging, and working in jobs that don't offer decent conditions and pay. Some people turn to drugs. Now, in this chapter on impact, the resistance was something that really struck us, not just the pain. There was a lot of bravery in this war, bravery shown by people, organizations, and families, much bravery to be able to live under these conditions and at the same time just forge ahead in their lives. Women who had their 8 children in tow who went into exile or were displaced and had to go elsewhere. Grandparents, in Putumayo, there's an example of a grandfather whose daughter and son-in-law were killed, had to raise his eight grandchildren. Women's organizations, neighborhood organizations, organizations of victims. This organization and the exile, all of this is a testament to Colombians' ability to move forward despite the difficulties. That's why we have a chapter on rebuilding your life, your personal life. Victims of sexual violence try to recover their dignity and move forward, but also making rebuilding your family life, your neighborhood life, community life, social organizations, and political organizations. And so there's much force and bravery there, and creativity as well, and solidarity. This is just part of the heritage of Colombia that hopefully is going to help us move forward. If I have 2 minutes left, I would just refer to some of the recommendations that we have. I would go so far as to say, honestly, I think that the recommendations, I would put them into one conclusion. War is not the way. War is not the way. If in Colombia we were to accept that, and it's a two-sided coin, war isn't the way. The other side is that the way is peace. Peace is the way. And if we were to wager on peace and what that implies, negotiation, yes, you do have to negotiate. And hopefully we'll do that with ELN and the other groups that are armed, that they also negotiate. But peace is far more than that. It's democracy. We need to reclaim democracy. We have our constitution from 1991. We don't need any others. We need to breathe new life into that, and we need to apply the Havana Accords. And now those recommendations issued by the commission, I would say with these three legs of the stool, we can move toward the future. But we have to demand this, that it be applied or upheld, the agreements as well, and the commission's recommendations. This is democracy, and democracy is the guarantee of rights, respect for life, and we need to take firearms, weapons out of politics. That was the wrong way. We lost our way that way. And that's very clear in the commission's report. We need to rethink security. An army should be an army for peace, to defend human dignity of all Colombians, men and women, especially the most vulnerable, to ensure. We're not talking about people thinking that security just means to have their own personal bodyguards, 30, 40 bodyguards, but or to kill those who are against us, but a police that isn't an armed police that goes out and kills people, but that it be a police for the citizenry, for peaceful cohabitation. This is a substantive change in these things and many other things, but we have to change the paradigm of how we think about drug trafficking. We can't think of a war against drugs. It's a war on top of another war, and that only begets more war. So this is an economic problem that's international, transnational, in which there are many big shots who are making a lot of money in the world, and the peasants are the ones who earn the least. As you know, between the coca leaf and the finished product of cocaine, it's a hundredfold difference. So we have to invert that rationale, that logic, and think of it in a different way. And the cultural penetration, political penetration of drug trafficking is where we have to think. You can't just kill kingpins. Kill one, 10 new ones emerge. You have to hit the snake in the head. And there's so many other things that I could speak at length on. But let me just conclude by saying, in Colombia, it's a country of regions, you all know that, and the regions are all very different. The conflict played out in different ways in different regions. Peace has to be regional. Peace has to be across the land, or it's not peace. And so we have to recognize this diversity, ethnic, cultural, political, regional diversity of the country, and try to reconcile, that is to give life and recognize the dignity of the peasants and their right to land. There has to be an agrarian reform, as the Havana Accords called for, and to reestablish the relationship between the countryside and the city. Otherwise, it's going to be a failed peace. It has to be something that everyone shares. Throughout Colombia, with that, I conclude. Thank you, Cristina. A peace in which the international community plays a very important role, as it has, and we hope that it continues to do so far more in the future. And among these international actors, the United States plays a very important role, and we hope that now many things are rethought and that there be international cooperation and a regional peaceful cohabitation that is focused on peace.
Okay.
Thank you, Saul. Thank you for your presentation. Like you said at the end, Colombia is not a country with one single country, but rather a country with many different cultures, as we can see here amongst the people who are represented. Another motivation to continue reading the report. We now have 10 minutes, 15 minutes for questions. So I'm going to ask the first one, and then I'm going to use my authority here. And then there will be a couple other questions and answers. I know you've already been handling the matter of socialization of the final report over the last few days, few months. How has the report been received? What surprises did you encounter? I have two questions here. Hernando, and I don't know what your name is. Let me clarify this. Please make your question as concrete as possible and less than 30 seconds, since I'm the timekeeper here. Thank you, Cristina. My name is Hernando Riveros. I'm from Colombia. I'm also a victim. I'd like to thank you and recognize your effort here for all the work that Father Rue and his team have done in the past. My question has to do with what's coming next. We Colombians in exile, on many occasions, dream of coming back, going back to our country. However, the situation is not ideal as of yet. Before 1985, what is the proposal for moving forward? Thank you. Thank you. I am here representing the International Peace Office for Latin America. I would like to thank you for this socialization, which I think is so important. I'd like to thank the international community for all of this work. You mentioned, Cristina, two Colombias. Could you delve into it a little bit further to describe what those two different Colombias are? Okay. Now I'm going to continue with some other questions. I'll start first. With the Truth Commission's work, we learned that there are two Colombias. Because we took testimonies in Colombia in all of the regions, but this is the first time that a Truth Commission is doing this work in exile. So by taking the testimonies of people in exile, we realized, look at all of this that's happening, everything that happened to them. Colombia came here into exile. And that's where the concept comes from, why there are two Colombias. And why, with all of the testimonies and everything that has been gathered, we think that these two Colombias have been joined together with this report, the truths that were revealed in it, everything that we learned from Carlos. Let me see here. Okay. I think about how the question about how the report was received at the commission, this has been a very important moment for us, where we saw that the report was being heard. There's important political information in there about changes. It's created a very favorable environment in different scenarios for the report to be well received in different sectors. Some have not read the report quite sufficiently, but I could say that maybe not enough emphasis was placed on FARC victims, but the majority of the testimonies heard by the Truth Commission are those from victims of the FARC. But we believe that over the last few years, Colombia has been moving towards a place that is seeking change to transform. And this really facilitates this possibility of hearing the truth, of people wanting to hear the truth. This is a country that is willing and wants to hear the truth and is even demanding to hear the truth. So the report has created this opening. So delivering the report to the president-elect, he received it and promised that all of these recommendations will be implemented on a permanent basis in different scenarios. I think it's also important to transfer the discussion to different areas, to also listen to the critiques, the objections, varying counter opinions. We have revealed the truth, but it's also something that's subject to discussion within amongst the citizenry and within society. We met with the high courts and also with the victims. This was like a trial by fire. Meeting with the victims and hearing about their experiences and their lives and everything that they transferred to us in good faith is reflected in there. And we would like to say that it was really gratifying. It was a relief, and it was quite moving to include the testimonies of these victims in the report. We're on a good path here. The political climate is favorable. And I'm going to give the podium to Saul in a second. But I just wanted to say that this is the right time to create a transformation in society. The suggestions are being well received. This is an empowered citizenry that is mobilizing and promoting these recommendations towards a better future. Pacho, go ahead. Okay, well, I guess it's my turn. About the question, what's next? Hernando, I think it was, who asked that. I would go so far as to say that anything technically could really happen, but let me tell you about what we would like to happen. I'm going to talk about what we want, which is where all of Colombian society reads the report and is moved by it, doesn't remain static, so that people don't say, oh, this happened to somebody else, this is really a marginalized issue. If we do all of this together, it will have a better result. This is very important. This needs to be something that's coming from all of us, a mutual agreement. If we're not all together, absolutely everybody, then it won't be possible. If we're going to continue having a polarized society, then We won't find our way out of this. We need to see a change of attitude within society to understand what happened, assimilate why it happened. Something that's more explanatory than anything else. We need to read the report, assimilate the information, process it, and have a collective consciousness to make sure something like this never happens again. We all have a lot of work to do. Number two, the next administrations need, not just the next one, but the next administrations, plural, over a long period of time, need to be committed specifically to implement the things that we said, the Constitution from 1991, the Havana Accords, and the Commission's recommendations. If the next administrations really put in the work here, then really we will have succeeded. This is so important. And then another condition people consider is the international community, and we want them to react to this and to help us stay on the right track. We all need to move out of our comfort zone to look at each other face to face and make a clear decision to walk together in the same direction. This is a mass social mobilization movement, and we need governments who implement these ideas and follow through, as well as the support of the international community. One of the Truth Commission evaluators said something that was really important. The tax minister was there too. He said not so long ago that don't look for early successes, quick success, to have a quick negotiation with the ELN. We need to recognize what happened in the war, and that is the responsibility here, because we've had more discussions with the FARC and than the paramilitaries, but we need to speak about the public force too. They accepted the responsibility in this matter. General Naranjo in Bucaramanga said, "I, as the director of the Colombian police, as the head of the intelligence agency, we see that we did not treat the university well. We treated the university as an enemy and we attacked it, and that is not right. I recognize this and I ask for forgiveness." And that was General Naranjo who said that, someone who's so high up. So the different forces, the different administrations, the branches of government need to recognize their role. There need to be some early victories to give way to future victories. I just want to say one of the nice things about the commission is that in the beginning, things were a little bit tough. I felt like there was a collective sense of chaos. But we all felt like we needed to work together to publish this report. And we indeed achieved it. There's 7,000 pages, I think you said. It is quite an effort to produce such a work, to have produced this amongst the people who were selected for this task. Alejandro, Carlos Bernstein, Valencia, and some other people. But I would like to call your attention to one thing since we're here talking about it now. The international community at the Security Council at the UN, amongst all of the members, they were saying we saw the case of Ukraine, which went back to war, and that stupidity of war. We have this thing that we're building all together in exile and in Colombia. And in that, we are completely united, without a doubt. This is an example for the world. Colombians are showing reconciliation is possible, despite the most brutal pain of the past. We can't give up in this effort. When the entire international community is watching us, the president of Spain was saying, I wish I had a truth commission like you have. The president of Mexico, Venezuela, has asked us for our assistance. They would like to do the same thing in Venezuela that we've done in Colombia. People are going to learn from this, so please, we need to understand that Colombia was served as a paradigm for reconciliation. And the other thing I would like to ask you is to please put fear aside. Leave terror aside. We need to move on from that. It will take a lot of bravery, but now is the time, with the ideal political climate, to handle this. It's the time to tackle this matter. Unfortunately, we have one other bullet point here on the agenda, and we're already running 20 minutes late. So the people who came from far away will have more time to speak with the panelists in a few minutes. So thank you. I'm just going to call Steve up here. The interpreter cannot hear the speaker. But let me say again, you're going to have a chance over there afterwards to speak more. Thank you very much. My name is Eduardo Castro Vailanta. I'm a member of the Periphery Group. I am also exiled here in this country. I have respectfully listened quite intently how you have been proceeding with the report, and it sounds like it was a report that has already been completed, especially with respect to violence in certain territories where the indigenous people and the Afro-Caribbeans live. In those regions, we have not discovered any positive effects of the peace process. Nothing has been minimized. Nothing has been reduced, especially in the city of Buenaventura. It's a city where there was guerrilla warfare and armed conflict, and the paramilitaries up to this day have not ceased the disappearances or mutilations and rapes and violations of human rights. So I'm sorry to say it like this, but it seems like you're finishing up with this process. But in our regions, the Afro-Caribbean regions, it seems like it's something that slowed down and wasn't completed. The government's reaction has been quite strong. We need to be aware and have a presence. The Mexican cartels, for example, have invaded our regions. We cannot justify that today Buenaventura and part of the Cauca and Narío region have more than 5 or 6 groups outside of the law that are engaging in drug trafficking, all of these displacements. Since the ambassador is here for the new government, we didn't have the ear of the previous administration, but I would like you to please keep in mind that there is a very delicate matter at hand. The Afro community is primarily exiled in Chile and now also here in North America, is the region of, comes from the Pacific region of Colombia. In Chile, they're killing our citizens, our brothers and sisters. This is targeting us specifically, but this is not something that people are aware of, and I think that the commission needs to be aware of this. How many Afro-Caribbeans have died in this conflict? How many have been affected? You're writing a general report, but it's not detailed enough directly with respect to those communities. Mr. Haido, thank you for that comment. And thank you for being so brave as to say that there is an entire chapter on ethnicity and things that have happened to the Afro-Caribbean community, as well as the indigenous population. I'm saying this with all of my heart. Everything that you just said is true. The commission went to Buenaventura. It went to the Esteros of Buenaventura, where so many people were declared as disappeared. And they today, even today, are still looking for the disappeared and murdered people. Like you said, this is something that's not over there. And quite to the contrary, that pain is still an open wound, an ongoing conflict. The community does not trust in the authorities, as you said. And that's what's been happening in the port region. This is something that has been very painful for us to see how many people have been displaced because of this. Carlos Burnside and Angelina went to Chile and researched the Afro population there, and also in Cali, the second largest city in Latin America with a Afro population, more than 1 million people. We also have found that there are other Afro populations that have suffered greatly in different regions as a result of everything that happened. So thank you truly from the bottom of my heart. That's why we say what we're delivering is so far from the final. There's so much more to do. There's so much more to say. We hope that once again, people can sow their crops and that good things are up ahead. There's so much work to do still, but we just don't want to do it through war, because war doesn't bring anything good. But there's still a lot of struggle ahead to completely transform our country. As a way of closing, I would just like to thank everyone who helped make this event possible. First, Maria Prada from the commission, who made a great effort. Thank you, Maria. To my colleague, Miriam Saikis from the Peace Institute, Lisa Jimena from the other organizations that have helped make this meeting possible. Thank you so much for being here. I would like to thank Christina, of course, for her leadership over so many years. I would like to thank Alejandra for all of her conviction, her courage in the southeast region of Colombia and overall, and her complete dedication to the issue. Thank you so much, Alejandra. And Dr. Saul, for his mental health and human perspective, his ability to understand the human perspective and how this affects us, these open wounds that are still infected in some cases. your ability to diagnose them. I went with Dr. Saul to the River Auca region, and I saw how he approached those communities that are still suffering very intensely from the effects of the war. So thank you so much, Dr. Saul. And lastly, Father Pacho, you reminded us and took me back 20 years earlier to the Magdalena Medio peace process. You continue to be a source of inspiration, sensitivity, humility, a servant of God as a Catholic, but also as a human being. And you work for the entire country of Colombia. You continue to be a guiding light for so many. You are a servant in so many ways. And the legacy is not just this book. The legacy of the work is the charisma, the passion, the spirit that the Father embodies for so many of us. So we would like to thank Father Neru for all of his work. Thank you for your love of Colombia, for your dedication, for giving us hope, for working shoulder to shoulder with us. Thank you for representing the United States in this. Thank you for your work. As the Institute, it is a great honor for us to have these allies on our side. The current president is ending his administration, but we have allies in Colombia, in the victims, and participants in many communities. There's a follow-up community for 7 years, but there is a collective task for the entire world to guarantee that the spirit of the report does not die out. The Institute of Peace is going to continue working on this. I would like to invite the victims to continue on to a private space for lunch and then to speak with the commissioners. The press representatives can proceed to the other room. Thank you so much to everybody. Have a wonderful afternoon.